Hey guys, welcome back. This is Tim from Tim's Electronics Lab, and today, as promised, we are going to take a look at my LabBench power supply. So yeah, this is how it looks from the top side, and let me grab it and show you the front. We've got two channels, channel A and channel B, with voltage control and current control, so constant voltage or constant current. Nice display that displays voltage and amperage. Switch for activating the channel and switch for activating the actual output with a LED. Same on the other side. At the top, you've got two. Oh, let me grab those. Oh yeah, by the way, these are silicon wires, banana plugs to alligator clips. They're very nice. And each channel is able to deliver, it's rated for 10 amps, but it's capable of delivering way more. And these wires definitely can handle them, the amperages. So let's remove the banana plugs to give us some more space. The only downside to this power supply is that both channels share a common ground, so you can't put the channels in series, just like you can with batteries, which is a downside. So the power supply case has been designed by me, which is I think you already figured it out. You know, this and this is not very equal, but hey, it works. And the only thing that is not good about this power supply and the case is that the screws are, yeah, there are a lot of how you're doing in there. No proper brackets and no nuts. Well, there are some nuts, but if you remove the screw, they'll fall out, and it's quite a mess. The electronics is quite a mess too. But it works, and it didn't catch on fire yet, so knock on wood for that. There are two fans on the top and two fans at the side to make sure that it stays cool. Now the fans were regulated by a microcontroller that PWM'd the fans according to the temperature, but that burned out or something and that didn't work. So this is the power supply. Here you can see the fan regulation board that isn't working. Yeah, a lot of different wires here. So let me just remove this connector here. Everything is connected through connectors, so that's a good thing. Oh, there's one. I remove the side fans, so we can take out this thing. So this is the fan controller that isn't working anymore. It's basically just an Atmel 328P with code on it. But as I said, I burnt it. So now I connected the wires directly to the 12 volt output of the power supply. Now this is a 600 watt server power supply that I'm using to actually power the thing. So I suggest we take a look inside. You know, I didn't want to ruin the wire bundle, so I grabbed an old I think this is 28 pin connector from a motherboard. That motherboard I had laying around, and I soldered some wires onto it. Now I used lots of interconnection boards here and there. This is, for example, the power switch board. I think this is the main power. Yeah, this is the main power switch board for the LED in the front here. Let me check if I've got a connector. I do. So let's plug it in, so you can see it in action. hope that nothing shorts out. So it's plugged in now. It's just a server power supply. So yeah. And when you turn it on, there you go, blue LED appears. Now the fans, when they're connected, start to spin as well at full blast, since nothing is electronically controlled. So as I said, you've got two channels. Switch them on. You can adjust the output voltage first before you finally switch on the output. And my camera is not really able to focus. There you go. So voltage and current and output. That's basically it. Also for the other side, voltage, current, output. So yeah, nothing spectacular in there. So let's unplug it again. Let's drain everything first. Okay, so yeah, that's this. Now there are two LTC3710, I think. Let me do a quick Banggood search. Yeah, there are two LTC 3780s as a buck boost converter, one for each channel, and they're able to deliver up to around 25 volts. Well, the product page says 30, but they're delivering 25 at max, 10 amps, but they're capable of doing over 10 amps for a short period of time. I think it's capable of delivering 10 amps continuous. Max, long term, 10 amps at the max, and long term 7 amps, and 4 amps continuous. But yeah, it's capable of delivering way more. And of course, some proper cooling below the boards. The fans are aligned in a pull and push configuration. Yeah, so airflow comes in from here and goes to there. And the top fans are pushing the air from the bottom, from the top. And of course, there's a fan here that pulls the air out. So basically like that and like that. So from the bottom and then through the power supply outside of the case, to the outside of the case. Yeah, the things are mounted like this. Now we've got a challenge, because the voltage that's being displayed on the output here is not the same as the actual output voltage. So I'm going to do a calibration. There's quite some difference, and I'm not sure. There's a trim pot at the back of the screens. Maybe if I do it like this here, let me zoom in. Let me grab a light. Like that. Here. Can you see that? No. That. Quite hard, because it's quite big. There. Oh, this way. Ah, this is better. So, tongue at the right angle here. Next to this connector, there's a trim pot. I'm not sure what it does. I'm not sure if it calibrates the amperage or the voltage. I'm hoping the voltage, but I'm not sure. Now, it's, as I said, it's a voltage and amperage measuring display. And the voltage is being measured by these two. Yeah, as I said, things fall out of here rather quickly. So again, there are two voltage sense wires going down to the, yeah, you can't see that, but they're going down to the actual output over here. And there, everything is properly crimped with heat shrink. Let's check. Yeah, this switches on and off the power that goes to the LTC. So not the output power, but the input power. So yeah, let's check how I routed this again. The purple. Oh yeah, everything goes through an PCB I designed. Let me check if I can grab one out. So right here, this is a PCB. I can remove it. Oh, as you can see, the case actually fell apart because of my very great designs. I'm not going to take it further. So here, PCB, I designed it so that I can connect a switch to it. I connect all the outputs and inputs to it, and then everything is working to minimize the actual soldering in here, because the wires are very short. And yeah, I needed to do a single botch, but apart from that, it's yeah, it's quite nice. There's also a resistor on the board for the LED at the front of the case. Otherwise, that just burns down. Now, I'm planning to do an upgrade. Basically, 3D printing some kind of L brackets, so the case is more firm. Because, yeah, as I said, the case is a bit how you're doing with all the screws. I think, oh, this is for the, yeah, everything is labeled, so that's a good thing as well. That's really nice. Alright, so as I said, PCB, custom PCB for controlling the switch, the output and the LEDs. And will be, that was my plan. So let me screw on the banana plug things on my multimeter. That's really useful. You can just screw it on. It's Dave EV Blocks multimeter. I love it. So let's put it in a mode that it's actually taking some load of the power supply. Let's put the backlight on. Yeah, you can still see it. Negative. Positive. All right. Grab the wire again and connect it and turn it on, off. Now we're at 14.1 volts. Let me check if I can show you output voltage. Are you able to see it like that? Not really. Let me just tell it. So it's at 14.10 volts. Of course, the output's off. Now the output's on. And it's 14.10 again. And it shows 14.2 here. Oop. Turn off the light to minimize the glare. Oh, that's the downside of this mode. It's not really that accurate. So let me check what happens if I turn this pot. Nothing. So nothing happens when I turn a pot. That's a shame, because that means that it is the amperage calibration I'm turning. Yeah. Well, the problem is that this drop of, well, let's say 0.24 volts, no, 0.14 volts, is the drop that's caused by the flyback diode. So if we turn it off and we switch the device to diode mode, overload, maybe other way around. Oh wait, I need to turn the outputs on, of course. No, this is not the flyback diode voltage. I'm expecting the 0.14 volts to pop up somewhere. No. That's not the... I'm still connected. Yeah, and I'm not sure what that is, but maybe the difference is even bigger. But it's strange, because the sense wires... Oh, I see, it's not strange. No, the voltage sense wires aren't connected to the actual output. They're connected to the output of the LTC. Come on, camera, focus. They're connected to the output of the LTC, which then goes into that PCB I showed you. So it's actually good that the, well, good. You know, it makes sense that the voltage that you see in the display is not the output voltage because of that difference. Now I'm planning to do a few upgrades to this baby. Of course, the first being 3D print proper mounting equipment, gear, things. And second, maybe, I'm not sure, the wires are a bit, are doom, you know? It's quite a bit messy in here. If you can, if you see it, turn the light on, you can see it even better. You know, it's quite a mess. Camera focus. Quite a mess here and there. Of course, I removed the trim pots of the LTC, and I connected the potentiometers. Do I see a loose wire here? Yes, I do. This channel. What's that wire for? Voltage. Oh. Yeah, it's I use jumper wires to solder the pot meters. Well, it's still working, so you don't hear me. Not sure what that is though, and why the wire's loose. So again, I removed the pot meters from the LTC and just wired them to the pot meters in front of the case, and it works fine. Great Scott, I think, posted a tutorial on how to make your own power supply, and I basically followed that and added the second channel, added a few more features. And I'm also planning on redoing the fan controlling thing, fan controller. This temperature sensor here, and yeah, it's oh, yeah. This is not very good. Yeah, it was in the beginning of my electronics phase, so yeah. I wasn't too good, and I'm not too good either now, so, but I think I'm better now at soldering. So yeah, everything I used for this power supply was bought from Banggood, yeah. Well, except for the custom PCBs, of course. So yeah, that's basically the power supply. I'm using it a lot and it didn't fail on me yet, which is quite a big surprise, quite a big surprise actually. Oh, there's you know, there the holes at the top of the case are quite big and sometimes things fall in, and I can see one thing that fell in here, but I can't reach it with my fingers, and I can with tweezers. There you go. So the upgrades I'd like to do are the L brackets, resolder the voltage sense wires to the actual output, maybe create a PCB for the actual output connectors, because they're soldered directly onto a little ring that's screwed onto the output terminals of the wires, which is not that good, because sometimes the output indication LED in the front here just fades away, and when you tap it, it pops back up, indicating that there's a bad connection somewhere. And that also happens sometimes with the output, the actual power supply output. So yeah. But where's the second? Oh, there's, it's there. No, the wires are a bit messy, because yeah, I didn't want to cut off the power supply wires, because you're still able to use it as a normal power supply, I think. Well, not really actually. But yeah, this when this power supply fails, I could just swap out this one for another power supply and it still should work. So I think that's about it. That's about the things I wanted to tell about the power supply, I guess. You know, I'm not sure if this gets hot during intense and heavy loads, because I didn't really measure it, and since the fan controlled outputs also aren't working as expected, I'm not really getting any feedback information about the temperatures. So yeah, I'm thinking about measuring up the holes here and there, and then designing a designing brackets for the case. So I will keep you updated on this this upgrade tour, because yeah, it really needs an upgrade. There are so many things that are working but aren't working. Well, it's a surprise that it is working actually sometimes, because of the electronics flapping around in the breeze. The only thing that's properly secured is the power supply and those two LTCs. Yeah, and of course the screens, the switches and such. But that's about it. This one feels really soft. As you can see, the whole front panel wiggles, and you know, it's nothing, it's not something you'd expect from a, I think it's capable of 250 watt each channel power supply, because 10 amps, 25 volts, that's a lot of power. So 500 watt in total. Not sure if you can run it 500 watt in total. So 250 watt each channel. I'm not sure if you could do it simultaneously because of the ratings of the 12 volt rails, because this uses the 12 volt rails and then bucks or boosts it up to the desired output voltage. So you're always limited by the output current limit of the main power supply. But it didn't fail on me once. I tripped the overcurrent protection of the main power supply a few times, but that was due to a sudden voltage change. I suddenly whacked around the knob, and not sure what happened, but it tripped the protection. So turn it on, turn it off. This is just a switch that connects to the green wire of your 24-pin wire. So basically the on-off switch of your computer. So the power supply is not active all the time. This is basically a kill switch. So yeah, that's great. That's the power supply I've been using on my channel. So I'll keep you updated on the progress, and I hope to see you soon. Bye.
Thanks for watching this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you did, please leave a like. Make sure to leave a comment down below. You can also share this video with your friends if you think they will like it too. See you next time.